Dr. Milan Balakrishnan. He is an MD in psychiatry, DPM, PG, DHM consultant, and he is a consultant psychiatrist, a very renowned psychiatrist in Mumbai. And our second panelist is Pallavi Ghosh. Pallavi is the founder of Impact and Dialogue Foundation, and she is also an anti-human trafficking activist. She has been very active in rescuing the trafficked individuals. And so far in the last 10 to 11 years, she has rescued hundreds of children, women, girls who were rescued, even minors who were rescued for prostitution, bonded labor, etc. So we'll welcome both of them, as well as we welcome the guests, the audiences who have connected with us. Many people are texting me that they are connecting gradually. So we will not wait for them. We'll just begin, as already said, that we are going live on our social media platforms, and we'll upload video later on our YouTube channel. So I would also like to introduce Mr. Ajay Kumar, who is the General Secretary of Indian Overseas Congress, South Korea. As you know that this webinar is being hosted from the platform of Indian Overseas Congress, South Korea. And I'm very happy to say that the Indian Overseas Congress South Korea, this small political platform, is taking up the issues of mental health. So far, as you know, that no political parties in India has ever raised this issue of mental health. No one talks about the impact on the mental health when they talk about the policies. So mental health is usually not taken into account when policies are made. So this is a small beginning where we have started talking about mental health through the political platform. So it's a very crucial moment, and I'm very thankful to all of my team members who made this happen. We had we planned it long back, and now finally we are executing it. So let me welcome all of you here. And now I would like Mr. Ajay to begin with the questions to Dr. Milan.
Hello, Dr. Milan. My first question is, like, what how do you define, like, mental health issue, and why it's necessary to talk in diaspora or diaspora community and even in common?
Yeah, absolutely. I think to begin with, like you're saying, we tend to overlook mental health. Mental health kind of gets pushed under the carpet for various reasons.
Can you start your video, sir? Dr. Saab, we cannot see you.
My video is on.
Oh, your video is on?
I don't know.
Sorry for
interrupting. Yeah, my video is on.
Okay. So, Mr. Ajay, could you please pin the panelists? Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So, like I said, mental health issues tend to be pushed under the carpet because one, the major problem seems to be stigma. But it's very odd that the question arises that everything that differentiates us from other animals is our ability to think actively, be creative, worry, think about emotion more intensely. And that's what differentiates us.
There is a network problem, I guess, with his, because I am not able to see his video.
I also cannot see his video. I think is he still there?
He's still there, but there is a white thing, white screen that's coming.
Can you see me now?
No, sir, Milan, sir, we are not able to see you.
Your video is off. Can you, Ajay, can you put on his video?
I can try it. No, again. You should be able to see me now.
I think video is off from
No, we are not able to see.
That's funny because
now we saw you.
Yeah, it's okay. That maybe it's a little bit of a bandwidth issue.
That's perfectly fine. That's perfectly fine in India.
So mental health issues are often neglected, yet so important, right? Because where is this mind, man? It's finally within our brain, but we kind of exclude that organ, possibly because it's much more complex than all the other organs in our body, and that tends for us to not know enough about it a lot. But yet we don't know really everything about it. So that's where this struggle lies. Neurosciences are working towards getting there. But mental health problems are all around us. We're talking about at least one in five people suffering from some mental health issue at any point of time, with such a high prevalence of mental health issues, we just cannot afford to neglect it.
Okay, fine. That was a good point from you. So you said that we often neglect it, but we shouldn't be neglecting. So a related question, Dr. Milan, you know, everyone knows that we should talk about mental health. We should share our issues with our family or friends. Still, we have cases of extreme cases like suicides and all due to severe mental health issues. People do not share their problem. People do not share their hardships with anyone. They do not express their stress, tensions, emotions. Everyone knows that we should share it, but still they do not. What are the underlying causes behind this, and how should we deal with these issues if it happens with us? Suppose if it happens with an individual, how should he or she deal with such an issue?
Right. No, so I think the biggest problem there is not finding like a safe, comfortable space to speak in. That by safe space, I mean a person who's willing to listen without judgment, without quickly jumping to advice, without sort of giving you gyan or a diagnosis quickly. You know, we don't want, you don't feel comfortable talking in such a space. So you need a person who is willing to listen openly without judgment, also assuring that things will be kept confidential and will not be discussed with other people without my permission. So I need that kind of space. Also, a lot of times when you talk to family, for example, very often people don't talk to family because of their fear that family will find stress out and get more disturbed than I am, which will eventually worsen my problem, or that family will be dismissive of it and say that nothing like this exists. Right. For example, and a lot of I was seeing this young girl about 14 years of age who has come to the hospital now. And she says that I have been telling my parents for the last 6 months that I'm not feeling good. I'm not feeling OK. I'm not able to focus. I'm not enjoying life. I'm feeling very, very different about life than I was feeling before. And they kept saying that, no, there's nothing to worry about. This is not anything unusual. It'll settle down. It'll go away. So she kind of felt very frustrated and angry. And finally, she got into a huge argument with them, had a fight with them. And that is when they finally brought her to the hospital. So it sort of became that until she didn't make a big deal about it, she couldn't seek help. although she was telling her parents explicitly that I want to seek help. And one, again, because of stigmas, fears, parents want to say that, okay, it'll be okay, we'll make it okay. You are 13, what do you have to worry about? What do you have to be so unwell about? You know, those kind of things that very often family may not understand that these problems exist and the intensity of these problems. So now how do you solve this problem? I think one, of course, build awareness, make people understand mental problems in detail so that they can themselves act as that safe space. Also for people to talk, an individual should be able to identify someone like that, someone who makes them feel comfortable, reassured, and is going to listen, and is not going to solve the problem for them, but just be available to listen. Very often, just listening with intent helps a person get a lot of clarity on his or her own problem. So you don't have to provide solutions. Your responsibility is not to provide solutions. Your responsibility is to listen. So especially, for example, in your close-knit community, right? There's not a very large number of Indians in South Korea. It'll be 25,000-30,000 maybe. And so being able to sort of identify, may not be professional, but people who are empathetic, who can listen intently, and who can sort of train themselves in listening actively. These are people who can be identified and announced to the network that there are these people you can talk to in case you're not feeling okay.
Okay,
that was a very good point, Dr. Milan. So you basically mentioned about empathy. You mentioned about listening ability, that you should listen without giving any solutions. So you talked about humanity, and you also talked about a 14 years old girl. So I believe that there are some issues of mental health issues, even with children who are in their teenage, who are below 18, who are not adults. They are also suffering from mental health issues, all thanks to the environment and the world of today we are living in. So a related question to Pallavi, which I would like to ask, because Pallavi has been very active in counseling. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes.
Okay, fine. So Pallavi has been very active in counseling parents and the children who are suffering from mental health issues during this COVID-19 period, in the lockdown, when all of them, the children do not go to schools, you know, are also not going to the offices, they are sitting at home. So she has also got a good experience in counseling and knowing that what are the mental health issues associated with children. So may I request Pallavi to speak something about her experience and what are the issues that children are facing? What are the issues that parents are facing? How could we deal with it? How could we solve those issues?
So during the pandemic, so there has been mental health issues with children always. It is just that we are not aware about it, and we think that how can children have mental health issues? That's what we think always. But then during the pandemic, when I started talking to a lot of parents and children, I realized that there is one thing that children face is during adolescence, especially when they start realizing that, okay, they have grown up. Most of the times, a lot of neglect comes from the family, like unconsciously, consciously, maybe with the studies or maybe with the way the child behaves. And nowadays, parents are mostly working in ITs, and they think that just giving a gadgets or having some social media sites of children will help. So there is a big, mental blockage that children have. They don't interact with their parents a lot. They meet the parents only at night, only after when they come from work. During a dinner also, like, which is the best time to talk between parents and children. That time, most of the children, they are busy with their phones in social media. Parents are also. So that interaction doesn't happen. And with children, one thing that I have seen especially is children always are scared that they will be judged. Like, for example, they may like someone or maybe they are not performing well in studies, or maybe they are not able to have a lot, because when your body changes, like when you grow up, a lot of things happen physically and mentally both. So you are not able to, sometimes you are not able to comprehend it, especially with boys and girls. So they are not able to talk it to their friends also, to their teachers also. So they want to talk to their parents, but especially in Indian households, it's something very common that you are not allowed to talk everything to your parents. Like even if you want to talk, like most of the times, like you will be judged if you talk. So I will just mention a small experience. So I was talking to a 13-year-old girl. She was from DPS, and she met me in one workshop, and she started telling me that she was having a lot of issues during the pandemic. So when I asked her what issues was she facing, she was like, I am staying 24 hours at home. Earlier, when I used to come from school, my mom used to ask me, what do you want to eat? But right now, especially because I am staying at home 24 hours and my mom never talks to me, it seems like I have become a burden to my family. So she started telling me that. So I had to talk to her, and then I had to tell her, no, it's not nothing like that. Then she said that my parents do not talk to me at all. Is it because I am at home all the time? Is it because they do not miss me? Like, what is the reason? So I told her to give the phone to her mother. So her mother started telling me that she never realized that her child was feeling something like this, because the child was always in front of her. She did not understand that the child must be feeling something like this. Then I told the mother that you need to talk to your child. You need to talk generally, like, for example, when you are having tea, or maybe just how was your day? How did it go? Then the mother told me that she was also having a problem. She was also exhausted of working. Like, she had to manage her house, she had to manage her children, she had to manage everything, because maids and nobody were available during the pandemic. We had blocked everybody. Then she told me that, what about my mental health? She questioned me back. You are concerned about my child's mental health. Just think about my mental health. I am exhausted. I'm not getting any time free for myself. Even I have to teach my children. So that is the time I realized that people don't think about mental health. People don't talk about mental health. Mental health means, like, the moment we say mental health, it's a taboo. People say mental health matlab pagal. Like, the moment we say mental health, people have this thought. So then she told me talk to her husband. So when I started talking to the husband was like, ye kya hota hai mental health? Hame to kuch pata nahi lagta mental health ka. Hum to bahar jate hain. The husband was telling me, mere bare mein sochiye aap. Aap mere wife ke bare mein concerned ho, meri beti ke bare mein concerned ho. Mujhe to bahar jana padta hai saman ke liye. अब मुझे अगर कोविड हो जाएगा, मेरी बेटी को और मेरे वाइफ को कौन देखेगा? तो आप मेरे बारे में सोचे. देन आई मेड हिम रियलाइज दैट, सो यू सी योर मेंटल हेल्थ इज ऑल्सो अफेक्टेड, वेर यू आर ऑल्सो फीलिंग दैट बींग द ब्रेड विनर ऑफ द फैमिली, आप अपना जो दुख है, जो आपके मन में जो प्रॉब्लम है, आप किसी से शेयर नहीं कर सकते. सो आई थिंक नो द मेन प्रॉब्लम इज पीपल डोंट टॉक, पीपल डोंट शेयर, एंड पीपल डोंट एक्सेप्ट. They don't accept that mental health issues है, मुझे किसी से बात करना है. We lack empathy, we judge people. अगर कोई बोल रहा है कि उसको अच्छा नहीं लग रहा है, हमेशा हम उसको पूछते हैं क्यों अच्छा नहीं लग रहा है. जरूरी नहीं है कि अच्छा ना लगने का कोई कारण हो. कभी कभी ऐसा भी हो सकता है ना, कोई कारण नहीं है पर फिर भी आपको अच्छा नहीं लग रहा है. सो दैट आई थिंक दैट इज वॉट वी नीड टू टॉक अबाउट, वी नीड टू डिस्कस अबाउट, एंड वी नीड टू हैव समवन विद हुम वी कैन शेयर. दैट्स व्हाट आई फील.
That's a very good point, Pallavi, which you mentioned, that we need to share and we need to talk about it. I would like to mention one recent happening which happened in Korea a few days back. In South Korea, there was one guy from Kerala, he committed suicide. There was some kind of pressure for his studies or whatever was that. I don't know exactly what was the exact reason, but he committed suicide. So after that, we decided that, we were, of course, planning this session from a long time, but then we thought that we should quickly hold this session, because it's very important that people's mental health should be, we should discuss about the mental health of the people. And I was very sad when I heard that this extremely brilliant guy, he was pursuing PhD, he committed suicide. And then, we got in touch with the embassy and all and other people to know what is going on. But, the exact cause never come out. And so I would like to urge all the audiences who are present right now, the participants, as well as others who will watch this video later on our YouTube platform or anywhere, please share your problems, please talk to people, And identify your good friends, identify people who could listen to you and talk to them. And also to those, as Dr. Milan mentioned, that we need to just listen to people, we need to empower them. We don't offer them any solution. We just need to listen to them. So that was a very good point, Pallavi. And now I would like to ask Mr. Ajay to please proceed.
Yes, Dr. Milan. And just like before, the Pallavi said, sometimes we misjudge between like differencing the depression, stress, anxiety, and some disorders, sleep disorder or something like that. So how we can decide in which level of mental health issue I have and which phase, like I am suffering from depression or stress, how we should differentiate between them?
Right. So mainly in terms of like you said, sis, when we talk about stress, stress is something that we all experience and we are bound to experience, right? Stress is a universal phenomenon. You cannot escape stress.
Yes.
So stress is also something that actually makes us work hard, plan in advance. So exam, for example, can be a stress. So, but that makes students want to study, plan, have timetables, get ready for their exams, practice writing, all of that, so that they face less stress during their exams. So stress is an inevitable problem. But when stress levels are higher, certain conditions may lead to very high stress levels, right? For example, serious medical illnesses, chronic medical illnesses, many people with chronic pains. The stress is very intense and very chronic and goes on for a long period of time. When stress is repetitive, to describe it very biologically, stress leads to a release of certain hormones in the body, primarily hormones that we call adrenaline and noradrenaline. These are released from two organs that are small glands that are on top of our kidneys. Okay. So is released. Again, this is controlled by the brain, because the control for this adrenaline release is in an organ in the brain called as the hypothalamus. So when adrenaline, noradrenaline is released repeatedly, chronically, it tends to have a lot of change on the body. Changes in the heart will be increased heart rate, increased breathing rate, feeling very restless, feeling very agitated, feeling uncomfortable all the time. That is what we can describe as anxiety symptoms. Okay. This happens repeatedly. It starts to kind of also bring about changes in the brain. And this brings about changes in the brain, especially in the areas of the brain that are responsible for emotion. So the changes lead to feeling emotionally more disturbed, sad, a decrease in energy, low interest, not enjoying life, not feeling good about things that we used to enjoy before. All of these symptoms start to appear. These are symptoms of depression.
Okay.
When we, this depression becomes more and more intense and we're unable to find a solution to the biological problem as well as other, the depression leads to us not feeling like doing our work, not completing our work. So that adds to the stress again. So it becomes a chronic vicious cycle, and then these brain changes become more intense. Some other brain changes also take place, which reduce our concentration, focus, ability to concentrate, and even to remember things. So we find ourselves becoming more forgetful as well. So all of these symptoms could be a part of depression. More and more intense as this gets, this may become more intense, and there may be thoughts about dying, not wanting to live, life is not worth living, this may then lead to even actually making suicidal plans. And when this goes on for a period of time, there may be an impulsive time when you decide that you want to, things are really bad, and then there is a risk of suicide. So this is like a continuum. It's one thing leading to another, leading to another, leading to another. So it is something that various, we can pick it up and arrest it at various steps. So if you find any of these symptoms that I just described, from feeling excessively stressed, too anxious, symptoms of depression, to suicidal thoughts, this is the entire continuum of symptoms. So these are, if you ask me, not separate entities, but entities that kind of progress from one into another.
That is continuous process.
Pallavi, you'd like to add something?
Of course. So I will tell you. So I was just talking to my victims, like survivors, whom I rescue from different kinds of social evils. It might be prostitution, it might be forced marriage, it might be anything. Like, so what I have seen with them, like a lot of people say that like they do not have issues. So we need to understand that there are a lot of issues that are inside us. We don't even realize. Sometimes we don't even realize that we are having a mental health issue for so long. Sometimes it is just sometimes that we realize that, okay, fine, it's affecting our body, or we are losing weight, or it is affecting some part of our, some body organs. But most of the times it happens that we do not even realize. Like a lot of people do not even realize that they are suffering from PTSD, or maybe they are suffering from depression, they are suffering from anxiety. So I would like to tell a little bit about my survivors. So what happens, they go through both kinds of trauma. They go through a lot of physical trauma, they go through a lot of mental trauma, all this trauma. So what happens when you talk to them, they themselves do not know that they are in trauma, like they do not know. So you need to talk to them through different angles to make them realize that actually they are going through some trauma, or they face something. Only when you start talking to them, you ask them normal basic questions, they become like blank. Then only you understand that, okay, they have some trauma. After that, when you talk to them about rehabilitation, and when you talk to them about all this conflict resolution, you talk to them about counseling. I'm not talking about my survivors. I'm talking about general people also, like in our families, about friends also. Like during the pandemic, I know so many of my friends, so many couples, they had divorced. Like they separated. So many, some of my friends, they went to their parents' houses. The husband went to his house, the wife went to her house, so that they could stop that conflict that was going on between them. So a lot of people, you know, they just think that leaving a space will kind of make life normal or things normal. They don't even want to talk between themselves, like what is the problem. Like most of the times they think that if they share it, people will judge them. That's one thing. And then we do not believe in the concept of sharing, of me and my spouse sitting together, or me and my family sitting together and talking to a counselor. Like we feel ki counselor ko sab pata chal jayega ghar ki baat, wo pata nahi judge karega. And there is another basic thing that as counselors we should do. We should always keep it confined within us. Whatever our so-called, I'm not saying it's a patient, normal people, whoever shares, we cannot go and tell it to anybody outside. That is like breaching the trust. A lot of people do that. I have seen, especially during the pandemic, a lot of people heard stories about other people who are facing a lot of trauma and ended up divulging details to somebody else. Like Dr. Milan will be able to tell it more. You cannot share whatever one person has told you. You cannot share about it to somebody else. That's like breaching the trust. This is something that has happened a lot during the pandemic. This has been told to me by so many people. This is one reason that people were not ready to share their problems, especially women. Especially women and children, they were not ready to tell their problems because they thought that their husband might get to know about it, their families might get to know about it. It would create more discord in the family. So this is what I would like to say, that first of all, you have to accept it, that mere saath kuch mental health issue ho raha hai. Hum to accept hi nahi karte. If you ask me also, I also went to one counselor. I'll be very honest with you. I went to a counselor. The counselor started talking to me, and then she was like, aap to khud counselor ho. Aapko counseling ki kya zarurat hai? तो मैंने उनको बोला कि मैं काउंसिलर हूँ वो अलग बात है, लेकिन मुझे भी तो काउंसिलिंग की जरूरत. सो पीपल थिंक दैट नो यू आर अ काउंसिलर, यू कांट गो टू अनदर काउंसिलर. सो दिस इज अनदर प्रॉब्लम. काउंसिलर को भी किसी और काउंसिलर की मदद चाहिए होती है. सो हमें ये एक्सेप्ट करना पड़ेगा कि हमें मदद चाहिए. हम अगर किसी से मदद मांग रहे हैं ना, तो ये हमारी वल्नरेबिलिटी नहीं दिखाती है. इट इज नॉट शोइंग दैट वी आर वल्नरेबल. इट शोज दैट वी आर स्ट्रॉन्ग इनफ टू एक्सेप्ट आवर इशू प्रॉब्लम एंड टू टॉक इट आउट विद समबडी एल्स. सो दैट्स व्हाट आई वुड लाइक टू से.
या दैट वाज अ वेरी गुड पॉइंट पल्लवी. दैट वाज अ वेरी गुड पॉइंट व्हिच यू मेंशनड अबाउट. नाउ देयर आर मेनी ऑफ आवर फ्रेंड्स इन कोरिया. एज यू नो दैट मेनी पीपल, मेनी ऑफ द एनआरआईज इन कोरिया, दे आर आइदर स्टूडेंट्स और दे आर वर्किंग. सो I have come across many of my friends, many of my very close friends who are in extreme pressure, who are in extreme stress due to their workload or pressure of studies. Pressure of studies is very common among PhD scholars. Many of the international PhD scholars here, they are supposed to publish papers in international journals, which many a times gets delayed due to different issues raised by the professor, due to discrimination, sometimes favoritism or something else. Many of the students are unable to publish papers in 7 or 8 years, and you know their degree comes in difficulties. They get a lot of difficulties in getting their PhD finished, and there's this serious, very serious stress that I have given 8 years of my life for PhD, and what if this is my last semester? What if my paper doesn't get published? What if my I'm unable to defend my thesis? So these are the issues many of these students in Korea, they are facing, lab researchers, they are facing. Likewise, the work culture in Korea is also very tough. People have to work for longer hours. They are away from their families. Sometimes they are alone. So the work culture, you know, there's a very serious hierarchy. Address these issues related to studies and related to the work culture.
Yeah. Right. So, like you're saying, academics itself and research, I'm aware, is a very kind of difficult area in general, because there's a lot of pressure as well, as there are a lot of issues, like you said, about lot of interpersonal relationships come in the way of good publication, right? Your relationship with your professors, your relationships with other students, all of that sort of impacts your output. And it's more of a team thing than an individual thing alone. So it does create a lot of trouble, also a lot of pressure as a result of the demands of, say, university. But I think what in these kind of situations, it's important to have a more clear plan of how you want to execute research. Keep your professors very kind of strongly in the loop. Very often, this is a little digressing from mental health issues, but it's very often that professors sort of have an unmet need that the students constantly massage their egos. So sometimes you might have to go ahead and do that, you know. You might have to be more forthcoming. different So I think in that sense it's tend to be a little thin in academia or over the world. So students probably need to also kind of speak to previous students be able to assess what kind of professor or guide they're dealing with, and may need to modify their own ways of thinking in order to get their work done, so to speak. So I think that these are a lot of practical issues that students face, and a lot of practical solutions are needed, and practical solutions may actually come from people who have learned it the different way, so that the next generation or next group of students can use some of those ideas into make life easier.
I think Dr. Milan's internet connection is not good again. I think it's very, the bandwidth is low.
Hello.
Yeah. So your bandwidth is quite low. Sometimes your voice is cracking and we are unable to hear you now.
Just let me try. Problem is middle of the day, I could have done it from my laptop, but I'm not really so. I'm mostly on my phone.
If you want, you can rejoin through your laptop. Meanwhile, we'll have some discussion with Pallavi. I mean, you can have like 5 minutes. Yeah. Sure. We'll get back to this question again, because many of my friends, they are waiting for you to answer things regarding difficulties in work culture and all. I think, yeah. Okay. So Pallavi.
Yeah.
Let me put on my video. Yeah. So you also have very interesting experience of rescuing individuals who are trafficked.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that you also have the experience of counseling them, because it's really difficult for them to get to accommodate in the society back. Like, for mm-hmm. example, if there is a girl who has been rescued after 5 years, she had been trafficked, and then she faces a lot of difficulty in accommodating back into the society. And what are your experiences? How do you deal with them? Because I think that it's beyond my imagination. What they must be going through is beyond my imagination. I cannot even imagine. So what are the things that you guys mainly take into consideration, and how do you do the counseling for them? What are the issues that they are facing? This is a very crucial thing. And this, I think the many political parties, they should have some policies regarding these issues. So could you please elaborate on this?
Yeah, so I will just share a recent example. So I have a network of informers. Informers are like people, normal people like us. They might be going to different places, and they might be seeing people, and they might have some suspicion, and then they contact me. So this has been because of the work that I've been doing for years. So a recent incident in Sitamari, Bihar, was one of my informer was there in a marriage. So it was a marriage where, generally, in every marriage, a DJ, orchestra, matlab, they arrange for it. So now a recent trend that's come in, especially Bihar, where in orchestra, young girls are made to dance for the entire night. And so he saw this girl and he contacted me, and he told me there is something something suspicious about it. Can you just talk to the girl? So when I interacted to the girl, she told me, first thing was she was very skeptical to share, because you know what happens with trafficked people, they trust somebody who sold them off. Again, rebuilding the trust and sharing your sorrow with someone whom you don't know might take advantage of you, is very difficult. So I had to really convince her for 3-4 days to talk to me, and I will help her and everything. So finally, she told me that she has been trafficked, but not a lot of things, just a small detail. I told her, how long has it been that she has been trafficked? She told me 7 years. And I was shocked, like 7 years is a long time. She was trafficked when she was 12 years of age. And then I told her, did you ever try to go home? Then she was like, I am kept in a place where there is only grass and water. And I don't know anything. I don't even know the language, like the local language that they talk here. It's very difficult. I just told her to share some details of her family. She had nothing. She remembered nothing. She just had a number of the house where the father used to stay and the father's name. I had to coordinate with DM and SP. Anyways, that's a different story. When I talked to the father, I told him, did you lodge an FIR? He was like, no. I said, why? The father is quite an educated man. The brother is an engineer. He told me when this girl went missing, he had gone to the local thana, local PS. Police told him if he lodged an FIR, he will be beaten up. This was of Dhanbad. I'm talking about Dhanbad. Like Dhanbad, you know, now it's a proper town. And he did not do it. So there was no FIR. First of all, it took me 3 days to counsel the father and the brother. Ki aapki beti yahan pe hai, aap please aaiye. Matlab, the fact that they have to accept the girl. It took 3 days for me to talk to them, to tell them, your daughter is not at fault. Usne kuch galti nahi kiya hai. Uski taskari hui hai. Please samjhiye. And then they came. When I met the girl, first of all, I was not able to get the girl because they hit the girl. Bahut kuch karne ke baad, they found the girl. She came with sindoor and all that. Usko ye samjhana. First of all, usko hame ye samjhana pada ki aap shadishuda nahi ho. She had been staying like this for the last 7 years. So she kind of took it inside her head that she is married. But there was no marriage. So उसको ये समझाना पड़ा कि आप शादीशुदा नहीं हो, आपकी शादी नहीं हुई है, आपको घर जाना है. That took us another 3-4 hours. Then regular counseling. I'm still in touch with that girl. I'm regularly counseling her. She is not able to accept her new life. She still thinks that she is dancing in the orchestra. वो कभी कभी रात को उठ जाती है. उठ के she starts doing some steps at night. The mother told me because इतना trauma है उसमें. उसको लगता है वो हर बार डर के उठ जाती है क्योंकि वो ना घर से निकल नहीं पाती. शी इज नॉट एबल टू गो आउट ऑफ हर हाउस इन धनबाद बिकॉज शी स्टिल थिंक्स दैट शी इज केप्ट इन दैट स्मॉल रूम. सो यू कैन इमेजिन स्टिल आई एम काउंसलिंग हर. इट्स बीन 1.5 मंथ्स दैट शी इज रेस्क्यूड बट स्टिल वी टॉक एवरी वीक ट्वाइस इन जूम वेयर आई टेल हर वॉट शी लाइक्स. आई एम डूइंग सम थेरेपी विद हर वेयर शी क्लोजेस हर आईज एंड टेल्स मी वॉट कलर्स शी सीज. अर्लियर शी यूज्ड टू सी ओनली ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट. Right now, she's telling me that she sees some colors because this is because of the trauma that she has gone through. I personally think that she has to be counseled for another 1 year so that she completely comes out of it. So it becomes very difficult to convince the parents because society is not ready to accept. Na? The society outside their house, all the her neighbors, their children are engineers, doctors, like well-reputed people. But they don't talk to this child. वो उस बच्ची को ताना मारते कि आप कहाँ थी इतने साल, अब क्यों आ गई घर, जहां थी उधर ही रहती. सो यू कैन इमेजिन दिस आर ऑल एजुकेटेड पीपल. दिस आर नॉट इलिटरेट पीपल. दिस आर एजुकेटेड पीपल हु नो दैट दिस चाइल्ड वाज ए विक्टिम. शी वाज ट्राफिक्ड. आई हैड टू टॉक टू 2-3 ऑफ आवर नेबर्स विद हु आर एडजस्टेड टू द हाउस बिकॉज इफ दे कंटिन्यूअसली टॉन्ट दिस गर्ल, it will become very difficult for her because her parents go outside for work. Unko jab maine samjhaya ki aapki beti ke sath agar aisa hota, aap kya karte? Because this girl was not, she did not fell in love. She was roaming outside Dhanbad railway station when a random guy came with a handkerchief and put it on her nose and she became unconscious. And then she was trafficked. So it was not her fault. Uski jab galti nahi hai, to aap uske liye usko blame kar nahi sakte. वो एक विक्टिम है, आप उसको समझना पड़ेगा. सो आई कन्विंस द नेबर्स, आई टोल्ड देम द ट्रॉमा शी वाज गोइंग थ्रू. आई मेड देम थिंक दैट इफ इट हैपेंस विद देम, लाइक अनलेस एंड अंटिल यू आर इन समबडी एल्सस शूज, यू डोंट नो उसके साथ क्या हो रहा है, उस बच्ची के साथ क्या हो रहा है. नाउ द नेबर्स आर लाइक ठीक है, हाई हेलो बात करते हैं, बट फिर भी नॉर्मल नहीं है. सो यू कैन इमेजिन एक लड़की के साथ कितना साल लगता है उसको एक नॉर्मल लाइफ में लाने के लिए, कितना बात करना पड़ता है, कितना उसको रेगुलर एनकरेज करना पड़ता है, उसको मैंने बोला है कि गो फॉर ड्रॉइंग क्लासेस, गो फॉर डांस क्लासेस, गो फॉर समथिंग दैट विल चेंज योर माइंड. Don't talk what happened to you. I have strictly told her family members not to discuss those last 7 years with her. Just think that it's out of the life. Just don't discuss about it. Talk about the life before the last 7 years or just now when she has reached her. So, you know, we have to come up with different ideas, different thoughts. I had to talk to the school principal. वहाँ पे मैं मुझे उनसे बात करना पड़ा. वहाँ पे जो state की women and child development की जो ministry है, फिर SCPCR जो है state commission for protection of child rights, उनके चेयरपर्सन से मुझे बात करना पड़ा. हर किसी को ये समझाना पड़ा, आप किसी भी तरह उस बच्ची को ये फील करने मत दो कि उसके साथ इतना कुछ हुआ है. नॉर्मल बिहेव करो. सो दिस इज व्हाट इट टेक्स इयर्स. सो जस्ट इमेजिन इफ फॉर वन चाइल्ड इट टेक्स सो मच ऑफ टाइम, इमेजिन फॉर द थाउजेंड्स एंड हंड्रेड्स ऑफ गर्ल्स और बॉयज हु आर ट्रैफिक्ड. और एक चीज तो हम बात करते ही नहीं है, लड़कों की मेंटल हेल्थ के बारे में. लड़कों की मेंटल हेल्थ के बारे में तो हम बात ही नहीं करते. लड़कों के साथ इतना गलत होता है क्योंकि ट्रैफिकिंग में लड़कों का भी बहुत ज्यादा ट्रैफिकिंग होती है क्योंकि कॉन्सिक्वेंस कम होती है लड़कों के ट्रैफिकिंग में. बातें हम कम करते हैं एंड वी हैव सो मच ऑफ पेट्रियार्की एंड मैस्कुलिनिटी जहाँ पे हमें लगता है कि लड़के के साथ तो कुछ गलत ही नहीं हो सकता बिकॉज ही इज अ मैन, वो मर्द है. लाइक दिस कॉन्सेप्ट ना कि मर्द को दर्द नहीं होता, मर्द है, मर्द के साथ कुछ गलत नहीं होता, ये और एक प्रॉब्लम है. मैंने इतने मैन लेबरर्स को रेस्क्यू किया है स्पेशली पैंडेमिक में, जिनको 40 रुपए दिया जाता था उनके दिहाड़ी मजदूरी की, उनको अनहाइजीनिक बाथरूम यूज करने के लिए दिया जाता. ये सारे 30 35 40 साल के मर्द हैं. जब उनसे मैं बात करती थी वो तो बताते ही नहीं थे. वो बोलते थे कि हम अगर बोलेंगे लोग हंसेंगे कि मैं मर्द हूं, मेरे को किसी ने कैसे कुछ मतलब वायलेंस कर लिया मेरे साथ. सो ये भी चीज ना, ये जो टैबू है ना कि मेन डोंट हैव मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज, दैट इज आल्सो वी नीड टू एड्रेस. दे आल्सो हैव टू गो थ्रू द सेम काइंड ऑफ काउंसलिंग सो दैट दे आल्सो कैन हैव अ नॉर्मल लाइफस्टाइल. सो आई जस्ट वांटेड टू टेल एवरीवन, प्लीज डोंट थिंक वुमेन ओनली गो थ्रू मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज. मेन इक्वली गो थ्रू मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज. द फार्मर्स हैव गॉन थ्रू मेंटल हेल्थ इश्यूज. आई वॉज जस्ट टॉकिंग टू डॉक्टर मिलान इफ यू कैन हैव अ mental health counseling session for farmers in Ghazipur where I am working. So many farmers don't even accept the fact that they have mental health issues. Bolte hi nahi hai. But jab unse baat kiye to pata chala jo farmer 15 ghanta apne khet mein kaam karta hai wo protest mein reh rahe ki wo bore ho raha hai, uska mind block ho raha hai, usko kuch na kuch chahiye. Nukkar natak kar rahe hai hum, gana bajana ye sab kar rahe hai, lekin wo to physical labor karta hai na, usko to ye sab samajh nahi aata. तो इसलिए हमें उनके साथ भी काउंसलिंग करने की जरूरत है. सो दैट्स व्हाट आई वांटेड टू टेल टू ऑल ऑफ यू.
दैट्स अ वेरी गुड पॉइंट एंड आई थिंक एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम वी आल्सो डिस्कस्ड अबाउट दिस. इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी टॉक अबाउट द मेंटल हेल्थ ऑफ आवर फार्मर्स नाउ बिकॉज द वे द पॉलिसीज आर बीइंग डिजाइंड इट इज अफेक्टिंग every individual. Lockdown affected every individual. The unplanned, you know, policies of the government have been affecting different individuals. So we'll not go that deep into this session. Now coming back to the question for Dr. Milan, regarding the stress due to work culture and in academics. So we lost his connection in between. So Dr. Milan, could I request you to please proceed from the beginning?
Okay. Right. We were talking about the problems that students have with regards to research and the whole issue with a lot of work stress, with a lot of the hierarchical cultural differences, right? I think
exactly.
With regards to adjusting to cultural differences is something that's part of issue of mental health issues that are seen among all those who migrate, no matter to which country they're migrating to. Basically, any kind of severe change can be difficult for, is difficult for all of us, is more difficult for some people who are more vulnerable to mental health issues, especially anxiety and depression related issues. So I think what is very helpful in facilitating migration related issues is to have a strong support system of the Indian diaspora in that country. I think that's very beneficial because that gives us a sort of a roadmap as to how people process, build in life. It gives us a sort of sense of how a couple of years back people have worked through with problems. And the problems are more or less similar. They don't change much. So having a good, strong support system by the diaspora is something that is very essential in order to, like I'm sure it's there with you as well. It's when someone comes from India, there is somebody from the diaspora who helps out, helps them sort of settle down or at least kind of makes them feel welcome in the country. And that makes a lot of difference. That sense of initial alienation that people feel is that kafi had tak it gets taken care of. This again, with regards to the research issue, again, the research issues probably not in South Korea, all over the world. I see a lot of students from TIFR or Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. They have similar struggles, lot of difficulties with guides, a lot of interpersonal problems. It's a lot of communication problems, actually, more than anything else. So they're willing to do the work, but then sometimes the guides don't think they're doing enough work. So I think that is often because of a communication problem. And again, there it's very important to have this kind of having seniors around who will guide you, who are still students, who can sort of tell you how to work around this professor or how to kind of deal with this particular professor or this particular difficult area. So that kind of gives them an opportunity. Also, like I was saying, that professors and guides are often difficult to please. They can be very demanding. They would like their students to be, you know, sort of around them a lot of the time, discuss issues. They want to share their knowledge. So I think students also need to kind of temper down on that, in the sense that they should take it up to be more involved in discussions with their guides. Even if they find, very often there's an issue because the student thinks that the guide doesn't know enough, and the guide thinks that the student doesn't know enough. So that can often be a cause for a lot of what we call a passive aggressive conflict, meaning nobody says anything, but then when there's time for like signatures or important parts of the thesis, you get pushed around, things get delayed because of that. So that's and then you start to feel frustrated and angry and you don't know what to do. So that, I think, that is something that we need to address right at the beginning, not wait till the end. So if we look at professors, guides as someone whom we have to look up to, we don't have a choice. So you finally have to have that attitude of the boss is always right kind of thing, and say, okay, make sure that you're communicating well with your professors, then things will be a lot easier.
Yes, Dr. Funal. As you said, the communication is very important, and there should be roadmap and between the diaspora and the immigrants community. But the person who are coming the first time, so they feel settlement problem, the feeling of how I have to settle in the foreign land, and there are lots of issues. Like somebody is coming first time, though, he have to get visa tickets and all. There is a long process. So on that time, many people get stressed. So how we should address that issue and how we should take care of that?
Again, this whole migration issue does involve a lot of the paperwork and problems related to that. Things don't happen sometimes the way we plan. There may be a lot of delays. I think that's important to be that we are aware of those issues. That we are aware that sometimes things may not go as smoothly as we plan it, because from a people who tend to get stressed are the ones who tend to think in what we call as little more inflexible ways. We are sort of rigid. कि नहीं नहीं इतने time में बोला था ना तो होना चाहिए. या फिर नहीं हुआ मतलब either I am not good enough or this system is not good enough. So that leads to a lot of stress. This very rigid beliefs that things should happen the way I planned. So these we talk about these shoulds and musts as a cause of a lot of our problems. We tend to interpret situations as must happen. People must behave in a particular way to me, or that I must get my work done in time. So when we use these musts a lot, it leads to a lot of what we call cognitive errors. We say I must finish this in time, and if I don't finish this in time, then I'm a loser, or I'm not good enough. There's something not good about me, or work must get done in this time, or the system is a failure. So these kind of rigid beliefs are a cause for a lot of stress. So we need to be able to get rid of this, meaning reduce this rigidity and be more flexible. That it would, so sort of we need to, we call it self-talk, right? What we talk to ourselves is very important. We tend to talk to ourselves a lot without knowing it, right? There's something that is playing out in the background that instructs our mind, and then we respond in those manners. So once we start saying, it would be great if it had got completed in time. But even if it doesn't, then maybe I need to find solutions. Maybe I need to be, I'll need to look at ways of doing it. I need to maybe talk to more people to find other ways of doing it. So that flexibility is something that's very important. So once we train our minds to do that, we'll find ourselves getting, and this is like this is for all kinds of situations. This is for relationships. This is for work. This is for your personal life. In all of this, we tend to be very inflexible. We tend to be rigid. We tend to demand things from ourselves or from people, knowingly or unknowingly. And when things don't happen as per plan, we feel very, very distressed. And then we feel caught, and we're not able to find solutions then. We feel kind of so distressed that we then tend to avoid the situation rather than find solutions. Thank you.
There are related issues. So this was about pre-migration issues. And post-migration also, when you come from a country like India to a country like South Korea, there are hundreds of individuals every year, every semester, who face a different culture. They don't have friends here. They face homesickness, loneliness, and such issues aggravate into very serious mental conditions at sometime. The NRIs who do not speak Korean, they only speak English, find it very difficult to adjust in South Korea, because most of the things, everywhere it's Korean. You don't find English speakers anywhere in Korea as you find in other countries. So how do you explain such a stress, and what ways do you recommend for our friends who are facing such issues? Because this is a real problem, and hundreds of individuals are facing such issues every year.
Again, I think similar in the sense that these are problems that arise from what we called acculturation, meaning trying to settle in a new culture. So settling in a new culture, obviously, a stress. It's not easy always. It comes with its difficulties, homesickness, feeling disconnected. And I think, again, being a practical problem, again, needs a more practical solution. It would be nice to have like sort of buddy system when A comes to South Korea, for example, somebody from your group, from your larger group who has been there for a long period of time can act like a mentor, buddy, support, till that person settles down, feels comfortable, so that there is this person that can be identified as a person that I can talk to for my problems while I settle down, while I get into this new culture. So that I think this creating this strong buddy system would be very useful. So it can be like maybe more than one person as the buddy as well, but one person that the person can reach out to in case of any need in terms of settling down, as well as in terms of emotional needs. So that should be a good way that the community at large can help out new people. And then these people, once they have settled in, can be mentors for the next set of people who come in.
Really a very innovative solution. And in some of the universities in South Korea, when students come for language training, they provide this, I recall, they provide this these buddies, you know, and they call them that she's my buddy, or this guy is my buddy. So I think this is a very innovative solution, and maybe we can institutionalize it, you know, in our day-to-day lives. For example, the institutions like Indian Overseas Congress, South Korea, we can form such things, and I would request my team to think over it, and maybe through our Indian Students Coordination Unit or whatever units we have, we may think of such systems. So another work for our team now. Thanks, Dr. Milan. Ajayji, please proceed.
Dr. Milan, I have one more question. Like during the COVID-19, many people have faced financial losses. Due to that, they have gone in mental stress. So how do you suggest how to counter that mental health during the COVID-19 and due to like financial stress? How to...
Financial losses, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think COVID-19 has been unprecedented problem in that sense for the entire world, right? Everybody has at some level experienced some losses, financial, personal, emotional, a lot of these. But I think it's important to understand that COVID-19 being this kind of unprecedented crisis that it was, it will and is going to finally settle down. It will give everybody who has lost financially an opportunity to regain things. COVID-19 has also been a huge learning for a lot of people, not to take things for granted, not to the fact that a lot of people would have also realized that losing money was one thing, but it also meant that we didn't need all that much. The whole lockdown taught a lot of people that we don't need as much as we think we're running around trying to earn, and gave a lot of people also on the positive side a lot of opportunity to spend time with family or with close people. And then, of course, like I was saying, eventually this is going to turn around. It has already started turning around. the opportunity to earn will always be there. But maybe at the end of the whole pandemic, we need to rework our priorities and think of what is it that leads us in life? Is it only finances, or are there other things that you are passionate about? And do you think you might miss out on those? Because like COVID-19 also taught us that life is quite unpredictable. We can't plan too much in advance. So if there are things that we want to do in life that we are passionate about, we can't wait forever. We can't wait for retirement to do those. So I think that's something that we can learn from the pandemic.
That was a very nice point, Dr. Milan. And I have faced similar thing. You know, I have been in huge financial loss, but what I gained was, you know, the love of my family, and I have been with my family for a long time during this pandemic. So I always take it as a positive note. I mean, money I can earn always, you know. There were some financial losses, but we don't have to think so much about it. And as you said, that life is completely unpredictable. You know, anything could happen. I had huge plans. I had huge financial plans for this year, but I couldn't earn a single penny this whole year. But it's fine. I mean, people should understand that there are many more other important things in life. And of course, there are some serious, dire financial problems. So there should be some solution regarding that. But I have got a related question. A very serious issue of people losing their near and dear ones to COVID untimely. You know, and there are many NRIs in Korea, I know, who lost their relatives, near and dear ones, their friends. And they couldn't visit them to pay their last rites. They have been locked in Korea, and they are having some sort of mental issues related to them. How do you address those issues?
Right. This problem of loss, yes, very, very major problem. Also because even here in India, people who have lost family members, for example, couldn't see them towards the end, which was a very difficult part, right? Because most of these were within COVID wards where people can't visit and nobody can meet the patient. So even post the death, the cremation was also very quick and didn't allow you to sort of go through the rites that usually people do. When somebody passes away, and that doing these rites is an important part of grieving, and it's a culturally very important part of grieving. Also from a mental health perspective, it has a lot of value, in the sense that it's a sense of closure, it's a sense of that time spent in the rites, and people are around you, and that support system is available for some time. That support system is around for some time. So all that was missing this time around. There were no religious rites after death. So all of that had definitely had a lot of impact. So I'm sure for people in Korea as well, like, they couldn't have even gone back and seen all this happen. So there is that sense of not having closure. But grief is something that is a natural process of losing anything. People definitely the most, but even losing something, for example, even a large amount of money, that also could be a cause for a lot of grief. Or a relationship, you know, a breakdown of a relationship is also a major cause for grief. So the grief is not only about death, it's about any major loss. And grief is something that will resolve and heal itself, and it's different for every individual how they deal with it, right? For some, like you would have seen in the same family, one person deals with death by getting really busy in work, one person deals with death by by spending a lot of time spiritually praying, reading a lot of religious texts or books. So everybody has their different way of grieving and dealing with loss and death. So it's important to know and understand that there cannot be one template for all. You can't tell a person who has lost somebody that now you read religious texts for the next couple of weeks, you'll be okay. That's not how it is going to work. You need to know what this person wants himself or herself, or what this person feels okay doing. So once we're able to identify those things, it becomes easier to help them grieve. And so it involves a lot of taking care of yourself, looking at what is it that you like doing or you feel comfortable doing or you don't feel very distressed about doing. One issue with grief is the issue of guilt. That's a big problem. Very often when somebody passes away, for example, the biggest question, like in times when you couldn't travel, there could be a lot of guilt. Oh, I was planning to go before. If only I had gone, I could have seen that person. If I could have done this, this would have happened. So this a lot of if questions come up, and with it come a lot of guilt that I should have done something differently. Did I play any role? Am I responsible? A lot of these guilt questions will come up. So that is something that needs to be dealt with, because the guilt really increases the time of grieving. So once you're able to say that, okay, yes, you're feeling unhappy, you have this loss, but if I start telling myself that I'm guilty, responsible for this in any way, I'm going to create more trouble for myself. So making sure that guilt is put out of the way and kept aside, at least for now, and that I'm going to cherish the memories of this person, but I'm not going to get overwhelmed to a way that I am hampering myself. So it's again different for different people. Some people may be over and finish their grieving within 2 weeks. For some, it may take 6 months to 1 year to a couple of years as well, where they still feel the sense of loss coming up every time they're feeling sad or disturbed. So I think there is no fixed time. Also, it's okay to grieve longer. You don't need to fight it out unless it's really impacting your ability to do things or not allowing you to do the things that are important for you right now.
Thank you, Dr. Mural, for the answer. I have the similar connecting question, like when anyone lost any person or they want to go for any religious place for the mental peace or any religious place where they can pray or something, read some books and pray for that person or pray for the peace. So in Korea, there is very few temple or mosque, and even in some outer area, there is no. So we have to travel around 4 hour or something like that. So if we want to go for that temple or mosque or any religious place. So in difficult situation, how to handle like this religious mental stress, how to deal with them?
Would you like Pallavi to take that question and then I can add a little in the end?
Yes, sure.
Sure.
If that's okay, Pallavi?
Yeah. So if you ask me, I'll take my example. I have lost more than, I think, 60 people in COVID during my close, because most of my acquaintances or friends were all frontline workers in COVID. Either they were doctors or they were nurses, and most of them were from different non-governmental organizations trying to provide food, relief, and everything. So if you ask me, I'll tell my example. I was in Bangalore during that entire phase. I know what a trauma it was for me. Because in Bangalore, it was very different from how it is in Delhi. In Delhi, I know almost everything. I was in Bangalore for 2 years, and there are most places which I don't know. And even if I know, it was not accessible. I personally had blocked myself. If you ask me, I had personally blocked myself. And then I did not want to be clicked, like pictures, nothing. It used to be something else that you would click and post, but nothing about myself. And how did I overcome it? I started reading a lot of books. And there is something that I started doing, that there is something known as philosophy, Buddhist philosophy that we do. It is known as nature. This is what I did, I'll tell you. There is something known as nature in Buddhism. So that's more about Mahayana kind of Buddhism. So I started chanting. So there is this mantra, which is known as Namya Horengikyo. I started chanting it. And I started asking myself, why did I lose so many people? And why am I alive? It used to come in my mind again and again. Why so many people died? So many of my friends who, they did not even get to see their family members. It was just packed up and taken away. And sometimes I used to think that actually all of them had COVID, actually all of them. So a lot of questions. I spent a lot of time with myself asking. And one good thing that happened is that I lost attachment of all worldly possessions. I lost attachment of everything. I don't know if it has happened with anybody else, but the fact that we do so much of savings, we do so much of planning, we think we save money for a house, for a car or something. But, this COVID was kind of a big, introspection for all of us, that life is really very short-lived. You need to do whatever you can on your own capacity. And the best way, I know in Korea, I've been to Korea, I know it's very difficult. So the only thing that I would suggest to people in this situation is try to talk to people who are close to you. Try to talk to people. Try and do meditation. Try and read books. I will say everything try, because I am not in your shoes. I don't know whether it will be successful for you. Just because it worked for me doesn't mean that it will work for you. And a lot of people, even after going to temples and mosques, can't connect. I've seen people can't connect. For example, I can't connect. So you have to ask yourself, spend time with yourself and find out what gives you some kind of mental peace. What gives you peace? Whether it is looking outside that gives you peace, whether it is taking a walk in the park or in your balcony that gives you peace, whether it is watching something that gives you peace, what is it that gives you peace? You need to ask yourselves. Because one thing that we as individuals forget to do is that we don't talk to ourselves. We always talk to others. We don't talk to ourselves. A lot of things, if we just spend a little time with ourselves, that is also if your mental health is smooth and fine, you will get a lot of your queries answered. My mental health was on the verge of collapse during COVID. I started self-introspection only after September. Then I realized that I tried to find out what will work for me, because it's not possible that something that worked for somebody else will work for me. So we need to find out what will work for us. And in our limited capacity, we might not have a temple. I did not have any temple in my area, I'll tell you, in Bangalore. I was not even allowed to go outside my house. Because of COVID, people were in buildings, people were so, they panicked so much, they were not even allowing you to go outside. So I used to stand in my balcony. I used to stare at the big flyover, seeing so many cars are passing. This is life. So many people are dying, still life is continuing. So you have to come up with some ideas. Of course, there are people to help. So this is what I had to say.
Thank you, Pallavi. I think that was a important personal journey that you shared there. Yeah, I think that's what COVID has taught us, right? It has taught us that material possessions are not important. Life is, and again, a lot of people do face this kind of survivor's guilt that how come I'm okay and people around me have passed away, and seen that a lot in a lot of us, even medical professionals who have been working out in the field with COVID patients throughout the pandemic, we've been working, and there are lots of people who kind of some of them ended up getting infected and dying, and then a lot of the remaining ones still think about this whole survivor's guilt that why am I okay, or how come that person suffered? Right, back to this question, I think, yes, so religious places are definitely important for some of us to sort of, spend some time alone, just feel connected to the greater power. But at the same time, like Pallavi said, there's no need for a temple to be there, or a mosque to be there, or a particular religious place to be there. It's very often this prayer is our own introspection, looking at ourselves, finding out what is happening within us. This is something that helps us grow, really, because it makes us look at life differently, look at ourselves differently, and look at solutions to problems that may be hidden beneath these.
Thank you very much, Dr. Milan and Pallavi, for your answer. So now I would like to open this session for a question and answer. If any of our audience would like to interact with Dr. Milan, Ms. Pallavi, if you have any issues related with mental health, or due to any reasons, due to any problem, you can ask. You are free to turn on your video or turn off your video. It's totally up to you. And whatever you ask will be there. And if you want us not to share this video on our YouTube channel when you are asking the questions, we'll remove your part. So please feel free to ask any questions if you guys have. Anyone, please feel free to ask any questions to Dr. Saab or Ms. Pallavi. We have got many guests here: Zeeshan, Sua, Salman, Ruchi, Ria, Chandan, Atulji.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. My name is Adnan, and I'm studying at Cheonam National University, South Korea. It's really pleasant to have you that seminar. Thank you, Dr. So. And I have a question that generally that suicide rate, it is due to mental depression, majority cases. It is very high in Korea, in even China, Vietnam, this side, like you can say that greater China in the past. What do you think? What are the main causes that it is high in greater China? In the past, they used to say greater China, all these countries. And even in Korea, you can see that there are some special force, special job, that who save people, who have to be alert that people should not go to do suicide, even on from apartments or even from even in the sea. So they have force, that is particular duty. You have to save people life. What are the main causes behind you or behind this incident that it is higher rate is here, but actually, I was listening all the discussion.
Workers who are working in Korea, they are really depressed. And if you look at Nepali workers in 2019, might be the higher their suicide rate was really higher. And a total 43 Nepali workers committed suicide in Korea. And maybe in Korea, I don't know the exact condition in Nepal, the workers, they are committed suicide. Can you hear? Ajay.
Yes, we can hear you. Yes.
I could hear the first part of his question. The second part of question kind of got.
So he's mentioning about the suicide of the Nepali workers in South Korea. So
actually,
question of
I was saying that what are the main causes that suicide rate is higher in Korea? Because even Korea have some special force, you can say force or department, who control the suiciders. What are the main or basic things behind that, according to your perspective? Can you hear?
Right. Let me just check whether I understood that correctly. One, his question is, why is the suicide rate higher in South Korea, right, Adnan?
Yeah.
Okay. I am, as far as the local factors, I might not know a lot of it, but generally, suicide rates are higher in places where stress factors are higher, meaning in terms of a lot of financial losses, loss of work, loss of labor, those can be triggers. The mental health causes always, of course, remain more or less the same, in the sense that we are looking at about 1 in 5 suffering from depression, and those with depression have about 20-30% risk of suicide. There are many factors that increase the risk of suicide. One usually is availability of means to ways of suicide, right? So for example, in farmer communities, suicides are more by use of pesticides because that's available quickly. So that is also very often a factor. The other issues in terms of suicides are that a lot of cultural and religious factors also play a role in suicide. Like some cultures, honor is of a lot of value, and honor cannot be compromised kind of thought processes there, which also tends to increase the risk of suicide. So there are cultural factors, there are availability factors, and there are factors in terms of in terms of help seeking and availability of help. So having a good mental health care system, as well as increasing accessibility to a mental health care system, can play a strong role in reducing risk of suicide.
Yeah, okay.
I hope I could answer what you meant to ask, because I lost some of your last words.
Yeah, actually, the overall, if I look at oral answer, I'm satisfied. That's great. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, thank you. There is a question from Ria. My question is to both the panelists. I would like to ask how to handle peer pressure on a foreign land. Okay. Fine. Anyone, if you would like to answer.
Pallavi, you want to start?
Yeah, so I would want to understand what kind of peer pressure. Like, there are different kinds of peer pressure, right? We have peer pressure with our academics. We have peer pressure because we might not know the language of that land. We might not be performing well. There might be financial background issues. Like, there are different ways how your peer will pressure you. Sometimes they may motivate you. Most of the damn times they might try to pull you down. So I want to know, what kind of peer pressure are you talking about here? Like student life and office life. So yeah, student life, of course, whenever you go to a foreign land, it's very common. Like, for example, I am from Northeast. I belong from Assam, but I do not have those typical Oriental features. So I was saved from all the name calling when I came to Delhi University to study. Like, people did not call me a chinky, or people did not call me by names when I came to Delhi to study. But I think the best way is to try to understand why they are trying to pressure you. Like, what is the reason behind it? Is it because you are too good from them? Or is it because they are jealous about you? Like, there are multiple reasons. A lot of times we just think that they are angry with us, they don't like us. So we need to understand, why don't they like us? Is it because we are different? Or is it because we are better than them? Because a lot of times what happens, you know, most of the people are better. Like, I personally faced it. A lot of people did not like me in my college when I started my bachelor's, because I was better than them. I came from one of the interior parts of a railway town in Northeast, and I could do well in terms of studies. And they, most of them being Delhiites, being from Delhi, were not able to speak or write the way I could. So first you need to understand, what is the main reason for them? Like, why they are like angry with you, or jealous with you, or envious, or intimidated, whatever. That's the first thing. When you look at office mein, there is always competition. Remember one thing, I don't know if it applies to you, but it has always applied to me. Your colleagues can never be your friends. That's very clear. They can only become your friends when you leave that office and join another office. Like, it generally happens. Because a sense of competition always prevails, especially when you are in the same team. Like, there will be, you might be doing some work better. So I would suggest one thing. Why not do one thing? Why not try to find out what that other person is good at and what you are good at, and work as a team? There will be definitely something that you are good at, and there will be something that will the other person will be good at. Rather than competing with each other, why not we try to find our positive sides and say that, okay, you are good in this, I am good in this. Let's work together and let's give a good report, or maybe talk to the manager. So this is how I would suggest. Dr. Milan would be able to give some more inputs, but this is how I would suggest, rather than fighting with each other or having this feeling of being angry. Because see, when you are in a team, in an office, in order to make any project successful, there has to be unity. There has to be a lot of unity. Because if the team has some cold vibes between themselves, the project will not be successful. And it's not at all good to show that you are having cold vibes with your colleagues or your peers in front of your manager or your office, like the CEO or something. It really shows a very bad impression of yourself as a human. So I would suggest, if the other person is cold, you have to take the effort. You have to make sure that you do all this. This is what I have to say.
Right. Peer pressure, I think, is both can be helpful at times, right? When it's helping you do the right things, when it's helping you, for example, in the student life, work harder, study harder, it's good, right? The troubles could be when it's making you take decisions that you don't want to take, like, for example, experimenting with a substance or a drug, or getting into putting you at risk for addiction. I think that's where it's important to identify where things are going wrong, and also being able to say no I think that's sometimes very difficult for us in a group. That's where the peer pressure comes from, right? A difficulty to say no, and a difficulty to say that I don't want to do this right now. I want to take I don't want to try drugs, or I want to stay away from this. I think that's important. So constantly being aware of your values and principles, and holding by them, even if a group of friends wants to force you in the other direction. They will try in the beginning, but once they realize that you're assertive and you will not bend, they will accept you the way you are. They will say, okay, this is I don't think this works with her or him, so let her be and let her do her thing. But when there are things that are of common interest, she'll come out.
Okay, thank you Dr. Milan. Thank you, Pallavi, for your insights. Anyone else would like to ask any question? Please feel free. Or if you want to send a personal message to Dr. Milan or Pallavi, you can do that as well. That's also fine. They will not disclose your identity. Is there anyone? You can raise your hand, so you can just say yes. Or you can unmute yourself. Please feel free. Okay, fine. I think that there's no one who wants to ask any question. So we are at the end of this program now. I would like to thank Dr. Milan and Ms. Pallavi for accepting the offer to come and to give a mental health counselings and talk about mental health to our NRI community. We'll be releasing the video soon on our YouTube channel as well. And thank you all the participants and all the Indian Overseas Congress South Korea members and office bearers who made this happen. Thank you very much, everyone. I hope we can have both of you on the panel next time as well.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thank Mal you. And Palvi.
Thank you, Dr.
Rajan.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Kisler. Yep. And thank you to all those joining.
Okay, let's